So, next up, we are privileged to have with us Mr. Vivek Mansingh. He comes with a deep background in technology. He's been working in the area of research and development with companies such as Dell and Samsung. A very deep knowledge of the consumer electronic space and the technology surrounding that. Today, he runs a fund called Yournest VC, and we're privileged to have him here. Could I call you up on stage? Thank you.
Still people, maybe people at the back, last row, can you hear me? All right. So, pleasure to be here. Mahesh, thank you for inviting me. And before I begin, just very quick, two questions. One, how many of you are entrepreneurs? Almost 70%. And how many of you are potential entrepreneurs? Okay, there's probably about 5%. So only entrepreneurs are coming, not potential entrepreneurs who should also listen to this, Mahesh. So you have to reach out to that audience. All right. Mahesh knows me for a long time, but I will still tell you that I'm going to share with you some of my learnings. And I have been very, very fortunate to work with people like David Packard, Bill Hewlett, Steve Jobs, Michael Dell, and John Chambers. These five people I have worked with, right, and learned a lot from them. So I'm not only a big company person. I have had three startups, one in the US, which went through leverage buyout. I had another two companies in India, US startups. One was bought by Philips, and one was bought by Oracle. So I have some credentials, so listen to me carefully because you can probably learn a few things from me. All right, so 10 commandments. I talked to Mahesh and Mahesh said that, share something that is very relevant and hardcore to entrepreneurs, and looks like 70% people are from that group. So hopefully you will learn a few things from this discussion. Number one commandment is that you have to be very, very passionate about what you do, right? The benefits of money, recognition, all of that is great. But ultimately, you have to be very passionate about your venture. You are going to commit 3, 5, 10 years of your prime time, which you will never get back again. And you better know that this is worth it. Any entrepreneur that comes to me, my first question to them is, do you understand the opportunity cost of what you are trying to do? And most don't. Most do not understand the opportunity cost. So before you take entrepreneurship, you need to understand why you want to do this. And I'm sure all the VCs here, whoever it is, the first question is, why do you want to do this? And you better answer it to yourself rather than answering to a VC. So very, very important, because I have worked with many, many, many successful people around the world, and I can tell you the one common thing among them is passion. And I'll come back to that again towards the end on how it plays a key role. But if you are not passionate, if you are just going to do it for next 3 years to make big bucks, 99% chances that you will not be successful. So better check your passion quotient about the venture, the idea that you want to take it forward. It doesn't have to be social venture all the time. That is also a great segment. But even your venture, for-profit venture, why are you so passionate about this idea? Very important question to answer. So my first thing is, make sure you are very passionate about what you are going to do. Second, know your space. 9 out of 10 companies I meet, when I ask them about the competitive landscape, they don't know. What they have done is, they have done some very frivolous sort of analysis, and they have found 5, 6 competitors, and they just use that to justify that they are unique. So there will be a sheet, one PPT slide on competition, where they will list 5, 6 of their competition, and they will show that they are the best. It's also not helpful to you, forget about whether you raise fund or not. 9 out of 10, or I will say 99 out of 100 people do not really know competitive landscape. If you are a global company, the job is even more tough. understanding your competitive landscape is a time consuming and very demanding job. Like I said, 99 out of 100 companies do not do it well. If you look at, I'm a PhD, if you look at my PhD thesis, it's probably about 500 pages. The first 150 pages is the work that has been done before, which justifies why I'm going to do something beyond that. One third of the work is over 5 years period is spent on previous work. So please pay attention to competitive landscape, because 99 out of 100 people who come to see me can't, even companies that have been funded, let me tell you that, they can't answer the competitive landscape question. And this is a dynamic thing in nature. And do not create that slide which justifies and says that you are the best. That is just a hogwash. Okay? Very important. Find a role model of a company, maybe in your industry, maybe outside industry, but find it and say, this is the company that I admire and these are the things I have learned from it and I'm going to apply that. Very, very important for you to know. If there's absolutely no company in your segment, nothing wrong with it, but then you better have data to prove that. Many people come and say, I have no competition. They come and say, I have no competition. Right? Doesn't work. Only then you can keep your differentiated value proposition high. If you know competition very well and then you know why you are going to change the world, what is the reason for that, only then your differentiated value proposition comes. Without understanding competition, if you tell me what you do, it's garbage. Right? So please, even if you are funded, even if you are an entrepreneur today, even if you have been working on it for 2 years, please go back. I mentor companies. For your nest, I only do two things. I select the companies to fund, and two, I mentor the companies. Companies that have been funded by other VCs for 3 years, 4 years, can't really answer these questions. And when you push them back, they have probably burned a couple of $1 million for no reason. Forget about $1 million, they can be replaced. The 2 years time that has gone is irreplaceable. So very important for you to do. Differentiated value proposition is a key that you should ask this question every day. Differentiated value proposition. Kya hai aapka differentiated value proposition? Why would a customer actually buy you? Have very high conviction in your venture, your mission, your vision, whatever you have. However, keep listening to your customers, keep listening to your competition, keep doing the research on competitive analysis, keep talking to people about it, keep talking to your customers, and evolve as you get this feedback. I'm not saying you change your things every day, but evolve from there. Because in my experience of over 30, 40 years that I have been involved in this industry, I have found very rarely a company entering and exiting with the same business plan. There's nothing wrong in saying that my business plan is changing. Pivot is the word used in the industry. I'm pivoting. Pivoting, frankly, may be fine if you have found that for some reason you need to change the direction. But I'm not talking about major change in direction. I'm talking about evolving every day. Every feedback you get from customers, you need to digest it. That doesn't mean you change everything, but understand, listen, see how you address this issue and go on. So make sure your conviction is strong, otherwise you will not have a company in place, but it evolves based on all the feedback that you will get literally every day. Like I said, very rarely I have found startups that have exited with the business plan they entered. Prakash Bhale Rao, a very close associate of mine who has had several $1 billion exits, and 40 years experience in Silicon Valley with this, says the same thing. He says that not a single startup I have seen which has exited with the business plan it entered. That doesn't mean there is anything wrong. They are evolving, they are listening, they are changing, they are modifying, and so on. So listen to the customers and competition, etc., etc. Be a great storyteller. This is a big Indian thing. I have talked to a lot of Silicon Valley VC entrepreneurs also. They can actually tell me the story in 60 seconds, elevator pitch as it is called. In India, the entrepreneurs, I find they struggle to tell their idea. And not only minutes pass before I understand what actually are you doing. Sometimes 5, 7 minutes, 10 minutes, I am waiting to hear what actually are you doing. Right? So you should be able to crystallize it in 60 seconds. Any good VC I know, any good entrepreneur I know should be able to tell that this is what I am doing. Right? I am also a big fan of some kind of formula that explains your existence. For example, I am involved with a company called Vulcan Software. I can explain Vulcan Software in 30 seconds. What is it? It is ServiceNow plus better deployment and better features at one third of the price. It took me 30 seconds to explain that company. Any VC will know ServiceNow. It's multi-billion dollar market cap. So you need to have this capability that in 60 seconds you can tell your story. You have to be a storyteller anyways. And you will need that for recruiting the talent, you will need that for raising money, motivating the team, building partnerships and selling. So you better be a very, very good storyteller. If you are not, you are a technology guy, find a partner or a co-founder who can tell this story very well. Because this story will ultimately decide your success in the long run. Customers will not be attracted only to your technology, even VCs may not be only buying your technology. You need to be a storyteller with full of passion. So very, very important. Telling your story in 60 seconds. Try that. Try that. Even when you have this competition someplace, I would say, Mahesh, have that part of competition where they have to just explain it in 60 seconds. 60 seconds, the clock stops them. Okay, so I am saying now, 60 seconds, make it. And just stop them after 60 seconds. You will see how many of them will actually not even reach the idea in 60 seconds have passed. Right? Good thing for them to learn. This is, they are young people. They have to learn. That's all. I'm not saying there is anything wrong with them. Get mentors. Right? Very, very important. You can have a good mentor to me is one who can tell you what you don't want to hear. Right? That's the first qualification. Says you, this is garbage. Guys, your act is not together. Your partner is terrible. You don't have technology depth. Your competition is far ahead. All the things they should be able to tell you in your face without worrying about offending you. If you are worried about offending and you have mentor relationship, that is BS, not a mentorship. Okay? So have mentors. You can have more than one mentor. But at least one mentor should be who has been there and done that before. Bangalore at least is full of armchair mentors who themselves have not done it, but they are tremendous mentors. How can you teach swimming to someone if you don't know swimming? Yes, you know the theory, put hands here, put the leg here, put the face here, that doesn't work, boss. So please make sure that at least one mentor is who has done it and who has gone through this journey before. Very, very important. And it is part of entrepreneurial job for you to find a guy and convince them that you are worth mentoring. Those guys are not going to mentor just because you say, sir, I am this, I am that. No, that is not the case. And I am seeing many mentors. And even in VC industry, let me tell you, Vinod Khosla made the comment last time, I think about 6 months back. And his comment was that 60% or 70% of the VCs are useless. Then he says, I am talking about US. Imagine for India. What he was saying is that 30% VCs in US are the people who have been there, done that before themselves. Lot of partners, including Vinod himself, have gone through this journey. India is full of VCs who are spreadsheet champions. Startup has nothing to do with the spreadsheet. Yes, it's a great tool, but that's where it begins and ends. So please find a mentor who has been there and done that before and listen to them very, very carefully. Build a very strong organization. This is where also Indian startups I see a lot of problem with, right? And so why it is so important? Organization I'm talking about in a holistic way. So let me go over. Personnel determine the potential of your organization. So you hire people and build the team for potential of where you want to go, not for today. You will move so fast if you are successful that you will be obsolete every 6 months. Are you hiring people who can learn with you that fast? So make sure you are hiring people and building a team based on potential, not what they can do today. Motivation determines morale of an organization. Whose job is to motivate the team? Founder, entrepreneur, right? How much time do you spend on that? You assume, startups especially, big companies know this very well. Startups don't take time. The structures determine size and scalability of the organization. Even at a startup stage, how your organizational structure is created will decide how you will scale. Many companies struggle to scale in India because the structure is not in place, the right processes are not in place. People don't actually know their roles and responsibilities. Startups, I'm saying. So you talk to the team and say, okay, what are you supposed to do in the next 3 months, 6 months, 9 months? Struggling. CEO's job is to make sure that the structures are in place which help you scale. Vision determines the direction of an organization, obviously very important, and leadership determines the success of an organization. All of this creates an organization, and leadership is mean. 4 out of 5, or actually all of them, the buck stops with the founder or the CEO. If you are not paying attention to all of this and you think that when my company starts doing well, then I will actually go back and correct some of these things, it will not work. You will struggle to scale, people will be frustrated, productivity will be low, people will be leaving, quality will be low, and you will not be able to succeed. So these things are important even in a startup. I'm not talking about large companies. Create a winning culture. If you talk to John Chambers, I was with him in the last 2 days, last week. John Chambers will put number one as culture. CEO's job is to create culture in the team. Now, John Chambers, don't look at him today. Today he's retiring soon, but he brought Cisco to almost $55 billion company. But when he took over, it was almost a startup. Tens of millions of dollars of revenue only. So he thinks culture is the most important thing, and you need to create the right culture. Communicate even more. And you are busy, you are doing 10,000 things, I know all that, I have been there. But I think it's very important to communicate, appreciate the good work, create the culture. And culture could be very, very simple thing. John himself gave an example recently that it could be just one line that this is the culture we want. But have something which everyone follows, whether you are present there or not. Whatever you pick, we can talk more if you want. But culture is important from beginning. Keep innovation and creativity quotient high, right? Now here I also blame in many, many cases, see the challenging of status quo and find a better way. Innovation word ke andar hi hai, no way. Innovation, right? No way. When you say no way to the first obvious answer, the second one is actually innovation. I'm not saying you go to a lab and start developing some next light bulb and things like that. That's also innovation, different kind. I'm talking about a startup innovation that should be done literally every day, not by just your business idea. And if you do that, you will actually continue to have a leverage against your competition. So make sure you find idea generation, allow time for that, where people, all the teams, not just you as a CTO or as the, today I see in startups that the CTO has an idea of the innovation and then he or she controls it with them. That is not innovation. That is one type of innovation. Your whole team should be involved in innovation. Now you will say that, well, we are struggling to do the next release. Where will we find time for innovation? It doesn't have to be even formal meeting. During the lunch, you can discuss how can we do something different. Right? And also understand your whole team needs to know competitive analysis before they can do innovation. I see competitive analysis slide only in founder's office. If your team doesn't even know who they are competing with, how will they actually innovate? So please make sure that this is high on your agenda. I have always put idea generation as part of all my meetings. in a small or big company, formal or informal, but make sure that innovation coefficient is kept alive. Be an effective manager. This is basic, but I see people, especially in startups. Big companies know this inside out. Startups miss this point. Peter Drucker's book, if you want to read, Be an Effective Manager, go and read. But here is what it says, set goals very clearly. So roles and responsibilities at any point of time have to be very clear. Develop detailed plans. Even in a startup, yes, and it can change, but there has to be a plan. Execute with rigor. What is rigor? Rigor is about inspecting what you expect. As Dell, Balla will know, in Dell they said, inspect what you expect. Go deep into your reviews, etc., etc., so you can see the problems that are coming tomorrow. Measure progress, measure productivity. Startups don't measure productivity. It's a chaos. I understand it's a chaos. But within chaos, you have to find an order as a CEO, as a founder, and you need to make sure that the productivity is being measured. I'm astonished to see many CEOs, after I point them out, have gone and done few things and found that their productivity was 30, 40, 50%. How can a startup survive in their 50% productivity mode? And productivity is generally linked to quality as well, right? So very, very important that you do all these, celebrate success, etc., etc. Follow Peter Drucker, even in a startup, I will say that. Just because it is chaotic does not remove your responsibility of being a good manager, being a good culture creator, even being a good leader, being a good motivator, etc., etc. It's part of your job as CEO. Persevere. Many, many startups, or almost all startups that at least I have closely worked with, have faced death. Very close. Very close. One day money left. The company that we sold to Philips also came into that. All startups, Yahoo came into that. Infosys story, if you read, you will see that all the partners had given up. And actually, Mr. Murthy said, okay, if you guys want to go, I will continue. You can carry on. That is how Infosys came. iGate, Yahoo, Intel, many, many examples. They faced death. So you will have to persevere. That's where founder and CEO have to say, and that's where passion comes into play, which I'm going to explain why, but I think it's important for you to know that you will face death before success comes to your company. Guaranteed. 9 out of 10. Flipkart story. Any company you just take, ask the founders, and they will tell you that they face death. So be ready for that. It's not a picture book story. It is not. Any company I have seen come close to faces, okay, I'm done. And then things turn around. So an article, Mahesh, that I published in 2000, during the 2001, when the first Indian startup boom started, the title of that Business Week article was, Indian Companies Open Parachute Too Fast. So when that experience comes in, you open the parachute and you become a service company from product company. And then you are putting 5 people here, 3 people here, you survive, but you are no longer that company, right? So it's very important. So you better be prepared that death will come. It will come face to face. And that is where your passion, your conviction, your resources, your ability to take help from people around you, all of those, your mentors, everything will actually be helpful. But be ready for that. It's not a picture book story for a startup. Big or small, successful or not. First of all, we don't hear about unsuccessful startups. Nobody writes stories about them. So you only hear about successful startups and you think it's great. But even in successful startups, if you go and get a chance to talk to the founders, you will see that they will say it was one day when we turned around. And that day was very close to death. Ventilators were put on, everything was there, be ready, and then things turn around. Be ready for that. Passion is what will help you at that time. Why Mr. Murthy said, while Nandan and all the other partners said, I'm done. Because he had a bigger vision than making money. He had a bigger vision than seeking recognition. He was a man on a mission. And he turned things around. Rest is history, like they say. But this is true for all companies. Why does passion play such an important role there? Let me tell you. Passion is very, very important for you. And let me share the the thought behind that, the science behind passion. It's not just a word, right? So first, two ways I can describe. One is the 10,000 hour rule. You guys know that, what it is? Anything you want to learn in deep, there is a 10,000 hour rule. You have to do that for 10,000 hours. Only then you start going in the excellence path, right? Rahul Dravid is a close, very close friend of mine, and he will tell you 10,000 hour rule applies. Any person who has achieved excellence of any kind will tell you this 10,000 hour rule applies. You do something for 10,000 hours and then you start developing the depth in that area. So you think whether it's Lata Mangeshkar or it's Amitabh Bachchan or it is Sachin Tendulkar, Rahul Dravid, any game, any profession, anything, when you say deep technology, well, where will this deep come from? Not by reading articles in on internet. You have to spend 10,000 hours, whether it's 10 or 9, it doesn't matter, but it's 10,000 hours rule, given by the author of Tipping Point, 10,000 hours rule, right? Now, in our Indian industry, by the way, 10,000 hours means how many years? In typical working hours, 7 years, 2,000 hours roughly, or around that, if you take vacation and all, 5, 6, 7 years. Our engineers who are going to create this deep technology, after 3 years say, I'm ready for management role. Where is deep technology going to come from? Right? So, first is this rule, 7 years of working life, you will have to work on understanding this deep, whatever you are doing, in any field that you want. But this is the game changer, and this is what the formula that people have found. Or, if you are passionate about something, you are actually working 24 hours a day. Even in your sleep, and I'll come to the next slide, you are actually focusing on. And then what happens? 450 days. You cross that 10,000 hours. So you admire Virat Kohli, for example. They have to cross 10,000 hours very, very fast. You see Rahul Dravid's thing that even at sleep when he gets up in early days, he would actually practice shots. He was just playing cricket all the time, sometimes physically, sometimes mentally. And this 10,000 hours, all of these people who have achieved excellence of certain kind have amazing capability to use this 10,000 hours rule in very intelligent way. 1 year, 1.5 years, 2 years, they are in a different planet. Other people are not. As I say, 9 to 5, I have 6 patents myself, not a single one is born from 9 to 5. 9 to 5, nothing happens. The game begins after that. And if you are not there and playing field at that time, nothing much will happen. I guarantee that. So that is the rule number one. So if you are passionate about your venture, about you are a CTO, about technology, you should be thinking about all the time. It doesn't matter where you are. You are driving, think about it. Bangalore provides you amazing opportunity to think because you are not going anywhere. Right? So think and get passionately engaged. Now take the passion to a different level. Why people say passion is an amazing thing? Let me give you another science behind it. So how much of human brain do a common person generally use? 5%, right? Generally I am hearing 5 even at the back, right? Well, they say Einstein used 3% of his brain. So figure out now yourself where we are, right? Why do they say that? Because a very small part of brain, and I am simplifying things to the hilt, but it will convey the idea. A small part of the brain is logical. A large part of the brain is emotional. All our education and training is logical. So only that part of the brain can understand and have a conversation with us. Rest of the brain is just not using. Now, that rest of the brain, which is a supercomputer as against our laptop, is actually waiting for signal. But it cannot understand logical signal. You say, work hard, it won't listen. I need your help, it won't listen, it's all logical, but it understands emotional signals. Passion is that emotion. All the people who are successful and all the religions of the world say that when you have reached that stage Aham Brahmasmi, the whole universe has become supporter of you, because this large part of your brain is saying signal anywhere, and you are actually being helped by universe. In Islam, they say sari kainat koshish karti hai to help you achieve that. But first you need to ignite that other part of the brain. So you wanted to meet, let's say, Mahesh Bhalla, you know, and he's not giving you meeting time. If you are really passionate, one day you will see that he sits next to you on the plane. It's not an accident. It's accident created by universe, who is trying to now help you succeed, provided you have ignited this other part of the brain. And that only passion can do. Only passion can do. No logical, no push, no trial, no nothing. And that is why you see all these successful people are so passionate about this. So two big benefits of passion. So if you are not passionate about venture, go and get a job and do something else, even if you win an award today. You need to be very, very passionate so that you can actually take this company, and all of these resources will be required. In my own life, passion has played absolutely amazing role. I come from a small town, a small guy, many patents. This instrument on the right hand side is my first innovation, which I licensed to a US company and earned royalty on it for 17 years. Books, etc. All passion. I knew at one point what did I want to do. Just to give you an idea of this invention of the instrument that I did, after first year of my PhD, I was so passionate about it that I was not going to sleep, because in sleep I would get an idea, and that idea will keep me awake, because I'll be fearful that if I sleep then I'll forget this idea. So my wife said that, why don't you put a piece of paper and write and goddamn go to sleep, so that next morning you can work on this. But that was the level of passion. Next idea, that only, you know, hundreds of ideas. Within 18 months, see this 10,000 hours rule, working in my own case, within 18 months I had invented this instrument, which I licensed, and licensed it to a US company called Cambridge Acuscience. And for 17 years, nobody competed with my idea. I earned enormous amount of royalty, which made me financially independent. But that was not the goal. That was an after effect. So passion has played many, and I'm happy to talk about more. And nothing else, the most proud I am of this, when Steve Jobs said, Vivek and team couldn't have done without you, signed Steve Jobs. I worked with him in the second. I cannot show that for too much. Many people want to take picture, because I did not take permission from Steve Jobs to show it to other people. That's why I have even removed his thing. But getting that kind of thing from Steve Jobs was not a joke. Another very, very passionate guy. Very, very passionate guy. Let me tell you one story. Do I have a minute, Mahesh, right? One story. When iPhone was being built, Steve had said that it should be this thick, this big, this length, etc., based on pocket and all that. And the team worked on it. They were unable to reduce it to that thickness that Steve wanted. So they finally worked on a prototype. How many people here know the value of first working prototype? Any of you know that? Few hands. Because you know only one working unit of that type, and absolutely valuable. So they take this to his office and say that this is what we are able to do. We are unable to match your spec. So he looks at it, and there is a aquarium in his office. He goes, and only working prototype of iPhone he drops in that water. He didn't even test it, and bubbles came out of that. He said, look, there is space here. Right? And rest is history. They went back, the iPhone became that thickness, that length, that whatever dimensions, specs, and rest is history, like they say. So passion, he would use that, and this is true for all many people. John Chambers, I find him, Michael Dell, I find same, etc. I can tell some stories maybe next time, but here is my time that is ending. So have fun, enjoy the journey. Result, you don't know what it will be. 9 out of 10 startups will fail. We very proudly say that India is doing 10,000 startups, somebody says 20,000 startups, somebody says 30,000 startups. Well, let me tell you the bad news. If there are 30,000 startups, then 22,800 and etc. will close. I am telling you now. I have also told you what you have to do to not be part of that segment, but be on the other side. But if you don't do, ultimately one way or the other, you will not be able to succeed. So enjoy the journey, do what I suggest, and remember, you will never fail. You will either succeed or learn. Learning is the same value. Thank you very much.
I'm sure there have been many questions coming your way, but just to tell this talk has been very special, because just yesterday to a very good friend and special person we were talking, if I'm mutant, you just kind of confirmed I'm normal. So just give me a minute. I know all of you would have like a lot of questions, but we will definitely open only for three. The lucky three ones. Can I have the mic runners? Yes.
It is the back.
Yes. And the second one would be you. The second one would be you.
Hi. I really like your talk.
PhD from Queens, and then you moved to becoming a scientist, and then now you're like an entrepreneur. So how do you make this journey, and what made you shift?
Very good point, and actually it's a longer answer, but I'll give it to you anyway. So every time I benchmark my career in segments against the best. So my first thing was be best in my field. I had done PhD on, and absolute best benchmark was best in the US, and I achieved that, and the books and the conferences, and I was number one in my field. Then I got bored. Okay, so now what do you do? I could ask for my talks, anything that I wanted. I have spoken at every possible university you can imagine in US, etc. Then I set a different target for me, and I went into sales. I said, let me learn sales, because I wanted to do my startup at some point. So I knew technology, I knew how to develop technology, how to think through, and then I did sales. So for sales learning, went three level below my grade and salary, because who is going to give me a job of sales? I have never done sales in my life. So he said, okay, this is what we can give you. I said, fine. And I started there, and then I built alliances between Fujitsu and Intel, Fujitsu and Motorola, Fujitsu and Sun Microsystems, etc. Was very, very successful there, because in the other side there were generally engineers who were talking, and I was a very successful salesperson. So then I changed my path, learned sales, so learned technology, learned sales, and then did my startup. And if you don't know how to do these transformations, then you will not be able to succeed. Then I did a startup, which went through leverage buyout, right? So it was a planned strategy. At every segment of my life, I was very passionate, and my benchmarks were very, very high. And that is how I got to work with, like I said, John Chambers, Michael Dell, Steve Jobs, David Packard, Bill Hewlett. Interesting stories I can tell you. My general talk with management school begins with that story only. Who is the best leader, etc., etc. These questions come. I can't answer that today. But bottom line to your answer, you have to do these transformations if you want to be a successful entrepreneur. You have to find a way to do that. If you don't like, so be it. The key here, listen to this comment, which I tell my children all the time. The difference between successful people and unsuccessful people is very small. Unsuccessful people do well in what they like, but successful people do well in what they like and also in what they don't like. That makes them successful.
Excellent. Go ahead, please.
My question is, you are talking about the hiring the potential people in an organization, right? So there is a huge, as an entrepreneur, I feel there is a huge gap between the upcoming graduates from the college or university when it comes to the requirement of the organization. And in my experience, I feel that there is a training need to be needed. Even the basics of the organization needs to be trained. So, and you said that we don't run an organization for training. So how do I correlate this, and what's your advice on that?
What do you do? The good news is startups don't need thousands and thousands of people. You need 20 people, 30 people, 40 people, 50 people. If you can't find 50 people, you are not fit to be entrepreneur. find those 50 people. It will be difficult, but attract them. That's where passion, that's where storytelling, that's where all of these things will become important, and you will have to find. I'm on the board of several non-profits as well. Janagraha, for example, Dream a Dream. Do you think they can attract people? So the team of Janagraha's management is probably better than many profit, and these people are making roughly half the salary. How can they do it? If they can do, so can you. Yes, last question.
Yes, that's the last question.
I
know that many of you wanted to ask a lot of questions. That would be the last one. And as sir has also been saying, you've got that last chance. Make it a good one.
Don't put pressure on him. Okay, ask whatever you want. Yeah, so his question is about, some people could not hear the answer, winning culture. What does winning culture mean? I think winning culture means is whatever culture you want to build in your company, and this is CEO dependent. For example, if you are not understanding, one of the biggest problem I find in startups is roles and responsibility not clear, accountability not clear. And in India, accountability is a problem to begin with. People pass the buck. I was waiting for this email. I didn't hear an approval from this. I didn't do this. I didn't do. So you can take a simple thing that I will build a culture of accountability in my company. So if the customer complaint comes, nobody is trying to attack the customer. Oh, you didn't know how to use the product. Oh, you used it in a wrong way, etc. You actually take the accountability to the right place and say that, why did we not do it correctly? So that can be accountability. Similarly, it could be customer service. Similarly, it could be being truthful to each other. When you have missed a deadline, be honest about it and say bad news first. All of these are cultures that will make you successful in the long run. It's a longer answer. I can give you more, but culture is absolute key from the beginning of your company, not at a later stage. A lot of startup people feel that when I am successful, when I have crossed this milestone, I will start building the organization, culture, leadership, hire the right people, all of that. You are never going to get there if you don't have all these starting from the beginning. Understand? All right. I have to go, guys. I know many hands are there. Thank you so much.
You.
Use it, enjoy it, and be successful. God bless you.
Thank you so much. That was one talk, right? So, I'm actually out of words. And can you believe that? I'm out of words. Yes. So, if it was okay for an organizer, a founder of a company to cry, I would have done that 2 minutes back when you were speaking, because it's been years and months of time when you're around people and you're trying to prove something, and you feel alienated, you feel completely alone, and you feel sometimes you are the mad one out. And then you hear that voice and you suddenly feel that you're not dead, you're not the odd one out, and you are in some direction. And right now, we understand that this is Startups Club Demo Day, finale stage, all that. But for me, sir, this very moment is my moment as an entrepreneur. Thank you so very much. Thank you once again.